Good morning, Cornerstone. How are you doing today? It is good to see everybody out. I'm glad you brought your smiles today because, frankly, it's a lot easier to preach to somebody when they're smiling at you. When they're kind of snarling, it's not as easy. So I'm just tickled. Your verse today is Proverbs 15:30, and it says, "A cheerful look brings joy in the heart. Good news makes for good health." Does anybody need joy in your heart? I can tell you how to get it. I can tell you how to get it. It's a relationship with Jesus Christ and get in the Word. And we're glad today we've got a visitor. I know one visitor. Do we have any more visitors? The one visitor is Jim and his wife, Joni, isn't that right? Yeah, Heidinger. And so it's good to have them this morning. And we're going to go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we just thank you, Lord. Let your Word just fill our hearts this morning in our minds. Give us strength this day to walk in your commandments, to grow in our faith. And Lord, give us ears to hear what the Spirit says as we go through this service. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning. The announcements are printed in your bulletin, but don't forget that today after service, we have our fifth Sunday meal, which will be held downstairs in the fellowship hall, and that's being provided by the TNT class. As far as opportunities to serve this week, I want to highlight a couple of things. On Wednesday, we'll be receiving food from the Midwest Food Bank, and so we need lots of help here to unload the truck a little before 10 o'clock. And then on Thursday, we'll be delivering food to the high rise and to Fairway Apartments. So anyone that is available and that can help either of those days would be greatly appreciated. Are there any other announcements? If not, please stand for the call to worship. The law of your mouth is better to me than thousands of gold and silver pieces.
Your hands may be attached to me, but you understand me, for I may learn your commandments.
May those who fear you see me and be glad, because I wait for your word.
Our opening hymn today is hymn number 64, Holy, Holy, Holy. Yes. We're going to sing all four verses.
Rise to thee.
Alice join together in the affirmation of faith found on page 881 in the hymnal and also on the screen. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
It's time for our prayers, our praises. Does anybody have a praise for the Lord this morning? It's good to have Jim on his feet and feeling better, right? Amen. Anybody have a praise report today? All right. How about concerns, things we need to remember in prayer? There's so much flooding going on right now in Kentucky. We need to remember them in the eastern part of Kentucky. Anybody else? How about the number of people in the building? Does that not bother anybody? I think every week we ought to be saying, Lord, bring in more. Bring in more. And so, anybody else got a prayer request or I'm going to pray? All right. Father, Father, what a glorious day this has been. A good day yesterday, Lord. We thank you for your presence in our lives. Lord, without you, we are nothing. And we need your guidance and your direction. Lord, I thank you right now that your hand is on those people, that all of those that are affected by the flooding in the Kentucky area and on in other places. But Lord, I ask your hand be on them. I pray, Father, that you bring resources into the place to help them to build back, to rebuild, to find the things that they are fearful that they've lost. Lord, I pray for those families, Lord, that are really suffering right now. And Father, I also pray for the people that belong here. They belong here because they're yours. I pray you put an urgency in our spirit to be back in the house of the Lord, to all of us, Lord. I thank you, Father, for those that are visiting today. I pray, Father, safe travels for them when they leave. And I pray, Father, that you just guide us and lead us so powerfully every day that we cannot do it without you, Lord. We thank you for that in Jesus' name. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and glory forever. Amen.
Inside your bulletin, you'll find an insert. I'd rather have Jesus. We'll be singing all three verses. I'd rather have Jesus.
you'll join me in prayer. Father, it's time to give back to you. Lord, you were so good because you created us to give. And with that giving, Lord, you've blessed us. You bless us back. Your word says that. See if you won't open the windows of heaven and pour out a blessing we can't contain. Lord, we thank you for that right now. Help us to give and give exceedingly well. In Jesus' name, amen.
I was just getting ready to say, most of you already know Misty Garrett. She comes from the New Hope area. She's been singing with us at least two cantatas that I remember, or maybe more. But we're very glad to have her here this morning to sing a special.
In praise. useless chains with bleeding stripes, Paul and Silas prayed that night, and in their pain began to see their chains were loosed and they were free. I bless your name.
Thank you, Misty. This morning's scripture is from Luke 12, 19 through 20.
And now, the latest releases from...
I'm a ventriloquist. And I'll say to myself, you have plenty of grain laid up for many years. Take life easy, eat, drink, and be merry. But God said to him, you fool, this very night your life will be demanded from you. Then who will get what you have prepared for yourself?
I had you sing the song that was in your insert for a reason. Because he has to be everything. I'd rather have Jesus than anything. I can honestly say this morning, I'd rather have Jesus. You know, the message today is, what are you building? And I had read pieces of this, and it really spoke to me. I want to say this. By your actions, you're building a place down here and you're building a place for eternity. But what I want you to understand is, notice I didn't say heaven, because I don't know who's going to heaven. Only God knows that. But I know that you're not going to get there by church membership. You're not going to get it there because your parents were Christians or your grandparents were Christians. This is a walk that you have with Jesus Christ. And so when you ask him into your heart, he becomes your Lord and Savior. Heaven's your home. And I don't know about you, but I hope when I get up there, I see everybody in here.
Amen.
That, I love you, David. He's going to break you people free of this silence that sits in the building. I'm telling you. Anytime. Randy will join in with him. I got him. In John 14:15, Jesus said, if you love me, do what? Keep my commandments. Keep my commandments. You know, I want to start by asking a question this morning. And have you ever stopped to think about what you worry about? Ever thought about that? If I said to you, make a list of the last three things you worried about. We won't ask you to read it out loud. But I will tell you this. We live an insulated life. Let me tell you what I mean by that. You have a place to live. You have food on your table. You're not going hungry. As a matter of fact, we're going to have, is it Sloppy Joe's downstairs? We're going to have food downstairs afterwards. You are not in danger of starvation or homelessness, and you're not in danger of the 686 million people that struggle right now worldwide from poverty, extreme poverty. The problems we have, most of us complain about inconveniences. They're not threats, bodily threats. They're inconveniences. Let me give you an example. You know, much of everything, here's what the problem is that we have. We have too much of everything and not enough gratitude for anything. I want to talk about this in a minute. See, in comparison to the world, our problems are minor. They really are minor. And they've got a name for this. Do you know what they call people like us in America? You know what it is? It's not, you're not a third world country. You're a first world country. And let me tell you what that means. It's not good. Let me give you some examples. You tell me if you've ever said this. No, don't say it out loud. Don't even make eye contact with me. Just, I want to know, have you ever said this? My house is such a mess, there's stuff everywhere. My closet is stuffed full of clothes, there's no room to hang anything, and I don't wear half of them, don't have anything to wear anyway, don't have anything. You men are going, amen, amen, sister. Here's another one. Vacuuming and polishing and doing laundry takes me all day. This portion size in restaurants are too big. How many of you have said that more than once? There's nothing good on TV shows. I can't believe I bought a toaster without a bagel setting. Life is rough. Life is rough. And we're looking at this stuff and we're saying, I don't have this stuff. Why in the world? You know why we got so much stuff we don't know what to do with it. And I want to talk to you about third world countries right now, they're wanting to survive. That's all they want, is to survive one more day. They want their children to survive one more day. And we're worried about piddly stuff. We're kind of like a man that's in a scripture lesson we're doing today. And the scripture is about a man who had a first world problem. We may not have the same problem, but we've probably got the mindset that he had. So we're going to talk about a mindset here. It's found in, it's the parable of the rich fool. The rich fool. That's the name of the parable. And it's found in Luke 12:13. And I'm going to read just that one verse. It says Jesus is surrounded by people. And somebody in the crowd says, teacher, tell my brother to divide my inheritance with me, his inheritance with me. Now, Jewish tradition was and law was, that at the death of a man, his inheritance would go 2/3 to the oldest son and 1/3 to the younger son. So I'm sure this was the younger son saying, tell him to, it's not fair. You want to see when a fight starts? Go to an inheritance. Go through the inheritance. And after everybody's said and done and you're dividing property, the fight is on. I am thankful that we didn't have that problem. We didn't have that. I think that a lot of families do. But Jesus wasn't about to get involved in a family squabble. That wasn't what he was there for. Jesus is so wise. He could have made money, goats, whatever the guy needed. He could have just made it out of thin air, but he didn't do that. He could have easily solved that man's problem. The man would have been happy. The crowd would have been impressed. But no one would have learned anything about God. Nobody. And that's the greatest need we all have. I'm about to make a statement that some of you are not going to care for, but I'm going to say it anyway. Jesus did not come into this world to make your life better. He came in this world to die for you so that you might have eternal life with him. Your pleasures, the way you feel, oh, it's hot. Jesus, make it rain today. Make it cooler today. It's foolishness. That's not, God's not Santa Claus. God is there to bless us. He favors us. He loves us. He cares for us. He gives to us. But that's not the primary reason he came. It's to give you eternal life. You know, in the book of John 17:3, it says, now this is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom you've sent. Read through the first four books of the New Testament. You know what you're going to find? You're going to find that when Jesus didn't do what people wanted him to do, he had something better for him. If he didn't do what they wanted, he said, I've got something better. I've got something you need. Let me show you what you need. Jesus is our source. Now let's go back to Scripture. In verse 14, it says this. Jesus replied, friend, who made me a judge over you to decide things as that? And he said, beware, guard against every kind of greed. Life's not measured in how much you own. And then he told them a story. A rich man had a fertile farm that produced many crops. And he said to himself, what should I do? I don't have room for my crops. And I don't have room for all my crops. That's it. Then he said, I know, I'll tear down my barns and I'll build bigger ones. And then I'll have room to store all my wheat and other goods. And then I'll sit back and say, my friend, you've stored enough for years to come. Now I can take it easy, eat, drink, and be merry. But God said, you fool, you fool. You will die this very night. And then who will get everything you worked for? A person is a fool to store up earthly wealth but not have a rich relationship with God. I want to say this before I go any further. God does not care that you have money. It's okay. What he cares about is if money has you. And that's where you get in trouble. You know, we need to understand this isn't a parable about money. It's a parable about what you cherish in life, what you value in life, and what do you value. The fool was rich in the eyes of man, but he was poor in the eyes of God. I think it's ironic. Has anybody got a bill, a dollar bill, $20 bill, $100 bill? I'll take anything you got, anything. One of them's, Brad's got one here. I can't use a quarter, but I could use a bill. Remind me to give it back to you. Oh, I'll just take them all. Okay, did you ever notice that on our money, what does it say? In God we trust. Here's my question to you. Do we? Do we trust? Magic, it disappeared. You think there's a lot of money here, it's ones. Well, oh no, it's not. I want you to think about that. If I say to you, you can have God, or you can have your money to get you through life. Which one are you going for? I really will give it to you. Which one are you going to go for? Which one do you rely on the most? When things get hard, which one do you go back to? Oh, I've got money in the bank. I'm okay. What happened to this part about saying, Jesus, I need to rely on you? It's not wrong to have finances. It's not wrong to have savings. That's not what he's saying. He's saying when it has holding you so tight that it's all you think about, that's what you want to do is build that account up, and you don't think about others. How many of you remember Jack Benny? Remember Jack Benny? Tight. He was a tight one. And he was standing around one day, and a guy approached him with a gun, and he said, "Your money or your life?" There's a long pause. Jack stands there a minute, and the robber says, "Well," and he said, "Just a minute, I'm thinking. When you get to that place, you got a problem, I'm telling you. In Timothy 6:10, it says, "For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. And some people, craving money, have wandered from the true faith and pierced themselves with many sorrows." Money is the root of all evil. Is that what that said? It did not say that. What did it say? The love of money. That's different. Grandma Mary was dipping out a bowl of ice cream for her granddaughter, and she asked, "How much would you like?" And the little girl thought for a second, and she said, "Give me too much, Grandma." I like that little girl's attitude. Give me too much. How many of you like too much? Well, especially good things. We want good things. There's something unique about this story that I hadn't noticed before in the parables. And this is the only time that Jesus directly calls somebody a fool in the Bible. And so I looked up the fool in the Greek. And what it means is you have no inner perspective. In other words, the Word of God's not in you. You can't make decisions based on what God says. You got nothing in there but you. And so the Bible contains a whole lot of verses. If you go to Proverbs, you'll see the wise do this, the foolish do this. The wise do this, the foolish do this. Fools live only for themselves and for the moment. That's how you know if you're a fool. You live for the moment and you live for yourself. Do you want to get to the end of your life and have God call you a fool? Not me. I don't want to be there. Let's take a serious look at the difference between these two. Here's the difference. The fool saw his wealth as a storage problem. It was a storage problem. God saw it as a mindset problem. Do you know first world folks are the only people on the planet who have storage bins built out and we store stuff in it and we pay rent every month to store our excess stuff? How many of you know that? I'm not asking for a show of hands in here, but we'll have counseling session after church. If you are addicted to storage bins, we need to get those things emptied out. How many of you could say, "I've got so much stuff on my closet, in my closet, it's a crying shame"? I'd like to see a show of hands, and I'm starting with mine. How many things? Rest of your line, we'll teach on that next week, because I know people. All right. Jesus said it's a mindset that's wrong. It's not a storage problem. Joy Davidson wrote a book. She was from a prosperous family. She was an atheist. And later in life, she found Jesus in her 30s. And she wrote a book called Smoke on the Mountain. And in that book, she said this: "There's only one way to stop covetousness and the destruction it brings. And that's to want God much more, so much that you can't be bothered with things." It's all about him. That's why I chose that song that we sang. I'd rather have Jesus than silver and gold. I'd rather have it all. I'd rather have him. You have a choice to make in life. Which one's more important to you, your money or God? That's the bottom line. You know, There's only one way to change that mindset of, I want more wealth, I want more things, I want more stuff. And that's wanting God so much, you can't be bothered with worrying about filling your house with stuff. It's all about what owns you. That's the bottom line. Our love for God creates two things, two mindsets, and it'll change your mindset when you start chasing after Him. The first mindset is you're going to have a gratitude. When you start getting closer to God, you're going to find out you can just praise God going down the street. I'm telling you, they think I talk to myself. I don't talk to myself in the car. I'm talking to Jesus. Holy Spirit's riding with me. He's the only one with guts enough to do it. He is. My family doesn't want to ride with me, but He will. He's not afraid. Here's the thing. You know, when we get out here, how many of you have said, thank you, God, for this joy that you put in my heart every day, for the peace. When I lay down at night, I don't go ahead rehashing stuff. Some of you, your minds travel 10,000 miles an hour back and forth, and you can't get a good night's sleep. Your mindset's wrong. We need to get with God and say, God, thank you for that. Thank you for the gifts of the Spirit. Thank you for the fruit of the Spirit. Thank you for who you are. Thank you for what you're doing in my life. Those are the things that are important. One day it's going to be common. You mark my words. The second change in the mindset is we get this desire inside of us to start reaching out and helping people. We get this desire to, that's why you see so many Christians start soup kitchens. We've got one here in town. We started soup kitchens, and they've started, there's clothing places that you can take extra clothing. People have started orphanages and hospitals in the name of Jesus because they felt this passion that this is money that it needs to be forwarded into the kingdom. Am I telling you to give away all your money? I am not telling you that. But I'm telling you, when God nudges you and says, give them $5, take this and give to them. Do it, and do it in the joy of the Lord. You know, John Becker was a pastor in Vermont, and something happened to him that changed his life. He was cleaning his garage out. How many of you love that job? And he gets out, he's cleaning his garage, and he's hauling everything that's in the garage out into the driveway so he can put it in a better place. And his little boy is playing out in the yard. And his neighbor comes over. And the pastor says to him, he said, you know, he said, the more stuff you own, the more your stuff owns you. And the neighbor said this, maybe you don't need to own all this stuff. And he said, I stood there. He walked off. I stood there and thought, my son is over there playing by himself, and I can't play with him because I'm maintaining my junk. How many of you know if you own 5 cars, you just multiplied maintenance right there 5 times? If you have, the more clothes you have, the more, whatever you have, the more and more and more, you maintain it. Somebody's got to take care of it. I couldn't have 3 houses. I barely take care of the one I got. I wouldn't want to have 3 that I had to maintain all the time. He said, I looked at my son and I thought, I ought to be playing with him. I just read something that said, who's going to cry at your funeral? Because that's the people you need to be pouring into. And he said, I just stopped what I was doing, left the stuff in the driveway, and went and took care of my son. And we had a good afternoon. And then he said, my wife and I started getting rid of stuff. He said, we went over the top. We got into minimalism. I'm not there. I got to have stuff in my house. I don't have to have a lot of stuff, but I got to have things, something. They were minimalist. And then he decided that everything that he'd gotten rid of, he said, you know what? I want to start a family orphanage in Mexico. And he did. He and his wife both started it. You know, he said that one sentence, maybe you don't need all that stuff, that changed my life. It gave me the ability to help other people. Second thing that made this man a fool, You know who he talked to? Himself. There is nobody dumber to talk to than yourself. Really. How many of you have come up with great ideas? And you thought, man, that's a good idea. And then about a month down the road, after you took this and put it into action, you think, what was I thinking? As the dumbest thing. Well, this man, he was conversing with himself. He said, I know what I'll do. I'll just build me some bigger barns. And that's what he did. That's what he did. And Jesus is saying, he should have talked to me about all that. Let me read that one part again. The rich man thought to himself, what shall I do? I know I have no places to store my crops. This is what I'll do. I'll tear down my barns and build bigger ones and store my surplus there. And I'll say, you got plenty of grain laid up for years. Take life easy, eat, drink, and be merry. The rich man proved himself to be a fool because he lived as if there was no God. Now, I'm going to say something, and some of you may not agree with this, but that's okay, you're wrong. Okay, maybe not really. But here's what I'm going to say. I shouldn't say that. See, that's another one of those things where you just think to yourself and stuff comes out. You can profess to be a Christian. I can tell you all day long, I'm Christian, I'm Christian, I'm a Christian. And still live like there's no God. Do you know a lot of Christians, professing Christians today, live as if there's no God? They don't talk to him. They don't read his word. They just go their merry way. They can talk a good ball game, but there's no communication. There's no link with God. We were created to be linked with the Father, not to be out here winging it on our own. And God's saying, you need to listen because I've got things for you. He also lived as if his highest purpose in life was entertainment, pleasure. Look at the world today. They live for pleasure. That's the big thing right now. God's our creator. By God's hands, we were created in his image and for his purposes. Trisha Meyer is a senior research director at Microsoft, and she's a follower of Jesus, and that's rare in the corporate world. But she said, I have stood and watched the shackles of wealth choke the life out of people. In contrast, Meyer said, we started giving and giving generously. Down at Safe Haven, we had been given 10%. We started giving 30%. God was blessing us so fast that we just kept sending the money out. They don't know it, but I want to give 90%. I'm not there yet. We're not there yet, but we're at 30%. But we're taking care of people that are coming out of these women that are in shelters that have been in the sex trade. They're taking care of them. We send to the Appalachian area and to take care of the people in the they're hungry in that area. I went to school down at Asbury. It's not that far on over, and those people are desperate. There are people, we send to people internationally. We send to people nationally, and we send to people locally, 10% to each one. Why am I doing that? Because I believe in being generous. Be generous with God's money. You know, there's two quotes that she made. She said, being loved by God and knowing him is to have riches beyond measure. And the other one is, every time we give, we acknowledge that everything has been given to us by God. It's just on loan. We're passing it through. I want to say this. I'm watching the time because somebody told me they want to eat at 11 on the dot. I don't like to be bullied. But I do think it's a good plan. So I want to tell you about Jerome. St. Jerome wrote this in 400 AD. I love this. He mentioned in his letter a woman, and she said, I prefer to store my money in the stomachs of the needy than in my purse. I love that. I think that's a worthy statement. I do want to end with this story. Leo Tolstoy told this story, and it was about a farmer. And he was told, he was a greedy man, and he didn't have enough land. He wanted more land. And so he was told, if you give me 1,000 rubles, which is $16 in our money, if you give me 1,000 rubles and you can, as far as you can walk, that land is yours if you get back before sundown. You know what happened? He started walking. Well, first he started running. He was going to run. And he made good time. Noon came, but he thought, I think I could go a little farther. There's more land out there. Greed begets greed. And he kept going. And finally he thought, I've got to turn around and go back. Well, by that time, he's looking in the sky and he's thinking, I don't know if I can make it. The deal was, you got to make it back. He starts running, and he's running as fast as he can, as long as he can. And then he's gasping, and he could see the finish line. It was right ahead of him. And it says this, and I'm going to read this part. It says, as the sun began to sink behind the horizon, he came within sight of the finish line. Gasping for breath, his heart pounding, he called on every amount of strength in his body and staggered across the line just before the sun disappeared. He immediately collapsed, blood streaming from his mouth, and in a few minutes, he was dead. His servants dug a grave, and one said to the other, all you really need is a 6x3 plot of land. How many of you know that's where we're heading? Well, that was an upbeat ending, wasn't it? I'm looking at you, and I see depression all over the building. Okay, here's what I want to say. We don't want to end our life and it's all about me and it's all about my and it's all about mine. We don't want to end that way. We were born that way. When you ask kids to share, little kids, what do they say? Mine. Mine. And we say it today. And God's saying, stop saying that. It's not yours. I blessed you with it. I gifted you with it. Now use it for the furthering of my kingdom. There's people out there that are hungry. There's people that have needs. Even people in this building have needs. And they don't say anything about it. And they go out that door the same way they came in. I would give anything if I saw that altar filled every Sunday by people crying out to God. We've lost that. We've lost that hunger for Him. And I hate that. We need Jesus. We need Him first and we need Him foremost. Let's pray. Father, Father, in the name of Jesus, right now we come to you, Lord, and we thank you that you have blessed us. You've blessed us beyond measure. Everyone in this room has way more than they need. And Lord, you have gifted us with that. But Lord, help us to face life with an open hand and be willing to help those that need help, to bless those that need blessing. And Father, we thank you because you can nudge our spirit. And we can hear you, Lord. We thank you for that. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our closing hymn this morning will be 354. We'll be singing verses 1, 2, 4, and 5. Please stand.
I will ever
How many of you are glad you came into the house of the Lord this morning?
Amen.
Yes, amen. Let's pray. Father, I pray a blessing over these people as they walk out that door. Lord, I pray that the words that you spoke into their spirits will burn within them this week. And Father, that we will be a generous people, loving and blessing and giving in Jesus' name. Amen. See you downstairs. Lunch.